Thank you so much
to our drummers, Sophia Root and Paul Garrett. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the families who came to join us, to our getaway families who have supported our students and our school throughout the year. Welcome to our trustees, and especially to the chairman of our board, Steve Dichter. Steve is celebrating his last graduation as board chair after 9+ years of exceptional leadership and service to this school. Let's all give Steve a round of well-deserved applause. Welcome to our volunteers who have contributed to make the full experience of this graduating class possible. Welcome alumni, who in turn will today welcome the class of 2022 into their fold. My heartfelt welcome to the faculty and staff who have engaged and supported this class over these past 2 years, and especially over these challenging weeks. Your professionalism, your heart, your spirit, even while many of you and your families have been displaced or lost homes, inspire me to do my best on behalf of all of you and our students. Thank you. Welcome to our first years, who have learned and lived with these second years in a spirit of intercultural understanding and joy and resilience through difficulty. And welcome, Platform Party, including our tireless deans, Alexis and Naomi, and today's speakers, Faith Abiodun, Executive Director of UWC International, and Ashindi Maxton, 1993 UWC-USA graduate and 2022 Giulio Regeni Award winner, and of course, Steve Dichter. Class of 22, in a spirit of gratitude, please join me in a round of applause for all of the people who have helped to change your lives by supporting your journey to and through UWC-USA. And to all of you who have supported the class of 2022, please join me in a round of applause acknowledging their accomplishment, the exceptional resilience they brought to their UWC-USA experience under challenging circumstances, and especially their continued promise. As I contemplated my remarks for today, I found my mind wandering. I thought about the Hermit's Peak Calf Canyon fire and the displacement it has caused. I thought about those fighting this fire at their own risk and frankly for minimal financial gain. I thought about faculty and staff facing personal adversity because of the fire and yet working tirelessly in full view and often behind the scenes to do whatever it took to help all of you to end the year with the full complement of traditions culminating in last night's wonderful Blue Moon celebration. I thought about Glorietta and how it has lived its values by receiving so many of us in our time of need. I thought about our first years and how much resilience they've shown through COVID and now fire evacuation. And I wondered how UWC-USA's culture might shift and change and deepen because of it. And of course, I thought about you, the class of 2022. Would I focus on the challenges that have beset your class? The ways in which your UWC was experience was different because of COVID and wildfire evacuation and now displacement? Would I focus on how much resilience you showed rising to the occasion of your exams under difficult circumstances and still managing to be present to one another as the year wound down in this beautiful new place that received us? Honestly, it was difficult to make time to write at all. There were so many decisions to make that affected other people's lives, so many worries about every member of the UWC-USA community and all of our vecinos throughout northern New Mexico, and heartbreak over the land I will not likely see recover in my lifetime. I couldn't find the time or the energy to attend to these remarks, to do the thing I knew I needed to do, which was pay attention to them. And then it hit me. Attention. This is what I want to focus on with your class. A brief reflection on the preciousness of attention. There's nothing like a natural disaster when it comes to getting our attention. A wildfire makes clear its demands. Move. Gather those around you and take them with you. Take what is most important and leave the rest. It's like our attention comes into its most pointed expression, showing itself to be the superpower that it is. But harnessing this superpower isn't easy. Among the many things that COVID has taught us, and it has been a relentless teacher, what COVID has taught us is that it's incredibly difficult to attend to difficult things for long. We human beings are masters at forgetting and denial and moving on. It doesn't matter if we start with powerful attention spans or attention deficit. We have to pay attention. It doesn't just show up to work for us of its own accord. So one of the most important questions for each one of you, our 2022 graduates, and for all of us, is what will you pay attention to? Each one of you dealing with this evacuation was challenged to pay attention to your studies, pay attention to your tests. I know it was difficult. Each one of you had more and less resilient moments during this time. Each one of you rose to the challenge with different degrees of success on any given day. I want you to know you weren't alone. All of us supporting you, the employees of UWC-USA and volunteers and friends, were undergoing tests of our own. We had more and less resilient moments during this time. We rose to the challenge with different degrees of success on any given day. We were being tested right along with you. And while we all learned different things during this time, you focused on your particular test subjects, we focused on supporting you by making tough decisions and contributing based on our mission and values that brought us to UWC in the first place, I propose that all of us received a common lesson, a gift really about attention, that it is ours to control, that how we apply it matters, especially in moments of adversity, that paying attention takes discipline and invites us out of our personal interest and into our personal responsibility, out of our fear of the unknown and into our resilience in facing an uncertain time and future, out of our tendency to criticize others for what they are doing or not doing, and into our most effective selves, making the difference only we can make because of where we stand and because of our roles and responsibility. Through these challenging weeks, I saw our students become the best students they could be, blocking out distractions and studying to get the job done. I saw our faculty become the best teachers I have ever seen them be, spending countless hours supporting displaced students, even though they themselves were displaced. I saw staff working from trailers on their telephones or driving up to 140 miles round trip from family homes or friends' homes where they had landed to make sure students had what they needed to meet the challenges of their IB exams, to eat well, to feel safe, to have activities in their downtime, to drive off campus for a break, to have a dorm life conducive to success. And I saw so many become the best community members they could be, preparing and serving meals, distributing water and snacks to other evacuees, organizing relief efforts for humans and animals, providing refuge for firefighters and other emergency personnel, and smiling and laughing and crying all along the way, because if we were in a tough situation, we could see all around us that others were suffering more than ourselves. And in any case, we were in this together. The world is full of disasters, and even more with distractions, all of which to conspire to steal our attention. These past weeks, we learned through trial and error that we can choose where we put our attention. The good and bad in life, it isn't a function of what befalls us. The life we make for ourselves and others is about where we put our attention. Do we choose to pay attention to our displacement or the beautiful place we were received in our time of need? Do we choose to pay attention to what we forgot to bring with us, or the resources we can pull together in cooperation with others? Do we choose to pay attention to what others are and aren't doing, or do we pay attention to what we can do in whatever roles we have? Where we put our attention is a choice. And when we choose well, we really do have the power to change the world. And now, I ask you to pay attention to Faith Abiodun, Executive Director of UWC International. Faith's work in the world has been impressive. In a career spanning nearly a decade at the African Leadership Academy, Faith served as an executive, leading the recruitment of thousands of young leaders from all over the world for ALA's programs. He also headed communications, marketing, and program recruitment and partnerships, helping to build ALA's global brand and developing strategic partnerships with governments, corporations, foundations, NGOs, and schools. Going back further, Faith's professional experience included a career in journalism and founding of a number of social enterprises. He's a member of the board of trustees of News Decoder, a global education news service, and he's an alumnus of the Executive Education Program at the World Innovation Summit for Education. Faith completed his undergraduate studies in his home country, Nigeria, and then went on to complete a master's in public administration at Syracuse University in New York. He is married and has a 3-year-old daughter. Impressive as Faith's resume is, there's something much more impressive about Faith that I've learned in the joy I've had to work with him in my capacity as a board member at UWC International. Faith has a tremendous capacity to pay attention to the most important things, to ignore the distractions while never ignoring the people who are sometimes the cause of those distractions, to harness his attention to advance a cause or build a strength or address a weakness that is holding us back. I look forward to attending to what he has to say to all of us. Please join me in welcoming Faith.
Thank you so much, Victoria, and hello, class of 2022. First of all, and above all, congratulations on your special day. I hope you feel very special. You've come very, very far. You've experienced so much, and you've earned the right to celebrate. And I hope you feel very special today, and I hope that the memories that you've built will carry you very, very far. I hope that the memories of this day will also live with you for a very long time. I'd like to start by sincerely appreciating our president, Dr. Victoria Mora, for inviting me to be here with you today and for courageously leading this institution for the last 6 years, and especially over the last few weeks. I'd like to equally extend my deep appreciation to every single member of faculty and staff, and everyone who works tirelessly to make this a truly special community. Everyone working in security, everyone in facilities, in student support, everyone who works behind the scenes. Thank you truly for all that you do. And I hope that you feel a sense of joy and a sense of pride on a day like today. You are truly a special and resilient community. And even though the last few days have not been the best of times, I've been sent with messages of solidarity and support from all around the world, all across the UWC movement. You're very loved, and everyone is wishing you the best. So today is all about the graduating class and a chance to honor and appreciate your incredible journeys over the last 2 years. Journeys that began in many different parts of the world and in many different corners of the United States. Journeys that took root in a historic castle, and journeys that come to a culmination here today in an evacuation center. You've had fascinating journeys. Individually and collectively, you've had interesting journeys. And frankly, our stories are not very dissimilar. We have a lot more in common than you might realize. And some people ask me if I'm a UWC alum. I'll start with the story of the founding of UWC, which some of you might know. It's most often traced to Kurt Hahn, a German educator who identified so much that was wrong in the world, especially around the time when he observed World War I. He observed how young men at the time engaged in the world. And he discovered that there was so much that was wrong about the ways in which they engaged with the world. And he dreamt of a day when young people could be brought together from all parts of the world to learn together, to live together, and to discover so much about the world and about each other in such a way that they would work together over the course of their lifetimes to forge a more peaceful world. His aspirations would lead him to found Salem School in Germany in 1920, and then Gordonstown School in Scotland in 1934, and with the help of several people to found Atlantic College in Wales in 1962. And that became what would eventually be known as the hotbed of the United World Colleges. And inevitably, that was the inspiration for the Armand Hammer UWC of the American West, founded in 1982. Known today as UWC-USA. And today, after nearly 60 years, the UWC movement has grown to include 18 schools and colleges, 160 national committees, hundreds of programs, and several thousand volunteers across the world who help to uphold this vision. In tracing the roots of our founding to Kurt Hahn and his vision for education, there's a fascinating subplot that emerges that forms my first connections to UWC. Because I'm often asked how I came to be in the movement. So it turns out that I have been a product of Kurt Hahn's vision much earlier than I had realized. We know what Kurt Hahn was doing in 1962, in the founding of Atlantic College, but what is less known is what he was doing the following year 1963. History records that Kodhan was in Nigeria, my country of birth, my country of heritage. And there he helped to establish the International School Ibadan, where 35 years later, I became a student, experiencing the exposure to global peers, to experiential learning, to authentic challenge, and to service, just as Kodhan had imagined. And if, therefore, Kodhan is our shared connection, it also makes sense that we should reflect on some of the other thoughts that Kodhan espoused, especially on a day like this. Kodhan believed that there is a way that young people can play a special role in helping to shape a better world. He knew and he said that to enlist young people in a lifetime of making a difference, we could choose to preach at them, or we could choose to force them to volunteer. But he believed that those approaches would be futile. He encouraged rather that we should tell young people that they are needed in the world. According to him, that appeal hardly ever fails. And so I say to you today, you are needed. You are needed to translate the values of UWC into a world that desperately needs it. The values of international and intercultural understanding in a world that is increasingly polarized and distrusting of each other. The values of compassion and service in a world that is extremely focused on personal interest. The values of celebrating difference in a world that is eager to judge other people by the sound of their accents or the texture of their hair. You are needed. You are needed to demonstrate the power of action and personal example by going out into communities around the world and deploying the skills and the competencies that you have learned here to make those places far better than they could have ever been if you hadn't shown up. You are needed. You are needed to organize for change, to endeavor for a more sustainable planet, to never stop believing that you can make a difference. You are needed to rally others, to speak the truth at all times, and to relentlessly work for social justice, to never give up, to never give in, to never doubt that young people with a sense of idealism and a supporting global network can change the world. You are needed. Wherever your path takes you from here, whether you go on to college, whether you take a gap year, or whether you go farther out into the unknown, I hope you never forget that you are needed. And I hope that this precious education that you have received comes to mind and helps you remember that it is worth a lot. I hope you will choose to pay it forward in many ways by devoting your time, your treasure, and your talent to enable similar opportunities for people like you. I hope that you will rely on each other. I hope that you will invest as much as you can in our global community of more than 60,000 alumni across the world who are cheering for you, who are eager to support you. I hope you'll always realize that you are not alone. And if you ever simply need to rest from making a difference in the world, I hope you remember that you have a supportive community that will happily catch you and refresh you for the next stage of your journey. I hope you know that you will always be fine. And I hope you know that you are uniquely loved. Class of 2022, I hope you take today to celebrate with your friends and your families. And I hope you take a moment to express gratitude to your teachers and to everyone who has invested so much in you. I hope that you will think fondly of the time that you have spent at UWC-USA and all the lessons that you have learned. We are proud of you. I am proud of you. We are all rooting for you. So congratulations once again. I wish you all the best and Godspeed. Thank you.
Thank you, Faith, and from wearing my board hat for UWC International, thank you for recognizing that you were needed by UWC. We appreciate your being with us. And now, let me introduce the African Chorus, led by Nina Lidar, Cindy Wani, and Luandile Dlamini.
sibamba umoy ephezu kwesantiza senle ephezu kwamandlwe namatibiye njengentaka ndiyakula njengentaka ndiyababa ndibambelele
ngamaphiko njengentaka ndiyababa
izangomso izangomso kuzawubalela makube ngomso izangomso izangomso kuzawubalela makube ngomso Liza ubalela makube ngomso Liza ubalela makube ngomso
One thing that has always amazed me about the UWC is that friends come out of the woodwork to help us. No matter where students show up, we end up with people who become friends of the UWC. And in the early days of the school, the UWC found a similar such person in Montezuma itself. As a foreigner, Sally Martin understood what our students were going through, and she often provided them with support and compassion. And upon her death, her family established the Sally Martin Prize, which is awarded to our graduation speaker each year. And so without further ado, I am going to present the 2022 Sally Martin Prize winner, Florencia Perez from Uruguay, who will give us her speech.
Greetings this beautiful morning to Faith, Ashindi, and Victoria. Greetings also to the parents and friends and getaway families who have come from across the state and the world to celebrate with us. But most of all, greetings, love, and congratulations to the graduating class of 2022. If I could give us one piece of advice from the whirlwind of emotions that I'm feeling right now as I stand behind this podium, is to believe in ourselves. Let's look around us. Let's look again. We have shared a path. Let's look at who we have met. Let's remember what we have seen and touched. All that we have tasted and felt. Everything we have loved and hated. All that we have distrust and kept. Everything we have given, negotiated, and received. All that we have created and discovered in Montezuma. UWC are three letters that together have the power to fill our flesh with thousands of emotions in a second. Some lived in silence, and some we shout between hugs where we now say goodbye. Closing a cycle or a phase or the narrative we have chosen to define what has been and probably will continue to be UWC in our lives is a path to discover and travel. The end, the goodbye, the last dinners in the cafeteria, the final looks and hugs, the final anger and arguments, the final laughs with friends in the woods. Today, we reach the hinged moment in which we transition to an unknown space of comprehending UWC through different lenses than our immediate reality. And my humble belief is the way that I can honor this experience, your lives, my life, and the UWC mission during our next steps is by believing in us as a collective and as individuals. To believe in us, singular humans from dozens of incomparable backgrounds, is to believe in the UWC mission. Believing in this utopian mission, the one we met and fall in love with, some of us by chance, and some of us through family stories. Mission which somehow ignited our idealism in all of us. To believe that we have lived and journeyed. To believe we have endured hours of endless conversations on friends' bedroom floors. Those who today are family. Every corner of our beautiful Montezuma campus is painted with our howls, complaints, silences, sorrows, and dreams. To believe that our bodies will forever remember what it felt like. To believe that we have enjoyed the privilege of this opportunity with all the awareness that we could learn. To believe in the community, recognizing the structures of learning and challenge, recognizing the moments of error and acknowledging growth. To believe that Montezuma will always be our home, and each one of the memories, experiences, and ephemeral seconds remain to stalk the ponderosa pines and mountains surrounding us. To believe in ourselves means having hope for a better future, to maintain our humanity and look at each other with compassion, to be a network in contact, to be a unity, to be a family, and to await the reunion with the land of enchantment and its people eagerly but not nostalgically. To UWC, thank you for enabling us to live an enriching experience. Friends, it has been an honor. Already in us, there is the power to believe in ourselves. Thank you.
That was beautiful, Florencia. Thank you. And especially thank you for reminding us what an embodied experience is like. That was wonderful. And now our a cappella chorus under the leadership of Sophia Root and Nina Lidar will offer a performance. Thank you, a cappella chorus and Tashi for that beautiful solo. And now, Reed Baumgarten, our alumni relations officer, will introduce our Giulio Regeni Award winner.
Thank you. Hello, everybody. Giulio Regeni from the class of 2007 was an Italian citizen and a doctoral student at Cambridge University in the United Kingdom. He was conducting his PhD research on the formation of independent trade unions, specifically the Street Vendors Union in Egypt after the fall of former Egyptian President Hosni Mubarak. He was in Cairo conducting field research when on January 25th, 2016, the fifth anniversary of the 25th January Revolution, he disappeared. 9 days later, his body was found. The purpose of the Giulio Regeni Alumni Impact Award is to recognize UWC-USA's alumni who have made substantial contributions and created impact in local, national, or global community and whose accomplishments, affiliations, and professional career honor the UWC mission. This award further illustrates the great value of the UWC education beyond the 2 years UWC-USA and celebrates the lifelong connection and stewardship responsibility as alumni to UWC-USA. Alumni are nominated by their peers, and the winner is selected by alumni. Let me share a little bit about this year's winner. Ashindi is the co-founder of Donors of Color Network, a first-of-a-kind philanthropic community of Black, Indigenous, Asian American, Latino, Arab American donors committed to systemic racial justice. In this role and others, Ashindi has developed funding strategies informing more than $100 million investments and from foundations and individual donors towards racial justice and a more inclusive democracy. Projects she created or co-created include the Reflective Democracy Campaign, the Youth Engagement Fund, and New Media Ventures. Ashindi was recognized by Inside Philanthropy as Donor Organizer of the Year, as a member of the co-founding team of the Donors of Color. She has also been listed 3 times in Washington Magazine's Young and the Guest List, and 40 and Under Geniuses, Visionaries, Crusaders, and Innovators Shaping Washington's Future, and the NAACP Power 40 list of most influential African Americans under 40. She serves on the board of Vocal USA and Way to Win. It is my honor and privilege to introduce the 2022 Giulio Regeni Alumni Impact Award winner, Ashindi Maxson from the class of 1993.
You are so beautiful. I am so happy to be here. I could not wait to meet you all. I'm also really honored to receive this award because everywhere I've been in the last lifetime that I've seen social impact happening in a really profound way, there is a United World College alumni behind it. Everywhere I've been, and the impact looks all kinds of ways. But United World College has a profound role in shaping the world that we live in, and to be recognized in any way in this situation makes me feel really shy, honestly. Like I have this like that emoji as my face learning that I won this. But I am able to accept it as a symbol, a symbol of one achievement on one path of social impact. I believe that you will make achievement in all kinds of ways, and it doesn't need to look the way that anyone else has done it. It could be as a ceramicist, a musician, a writer, an astronaut, as many of our other folks have done. I'm also conscious this week, I lost 2 of my mentors this month, 2 people who really profoundly shaped the work that I do, and so I'm conscious right now of being on a continuum of social change, that there are people who came before me whose work I built on, who supported me, and that you are the future. And I have been so conscious of this in thinking about talking to you, that you are the future, the people who we hope to have supported and shaped and influenced, and you're gonna have big work to do. So we especially want to shape, influence, and inspire you. I was thinking this morning about my own graduation almost 30 years ago.
And I was remembering that I left my dorm for the campus store to buy my class of 93 t-shirt. And I, you know, was just planning to go there and then come back and get dressed and get ready. But along the way back, one of my classmates was like, "Ashinti, you're late for the picture." And so those girls, like, coming in from the side, like, taking off their shoes, like, that was me. And I was late for the class picture. And then, as happened today, it was, okay, but now we have to go line up. And then we had to go to graduation. And I literally never got dressed, never got my shoes on. And I graduated barefoot. I don't remember anything about the ceremony at all. It happened super fast. And then I dreamed about it over and over again for weeks because it was over so quickly. But my really good news for all of you is that it was not over at all. I am here 29 years out to tell you that United World College is a part of my life literally every day. My closest friends are still UWC people, not even the ones I was close to on campus. The values that I learned here have guided my work forever. And I never find myself out of arm's reach of this school and its influence. So however rushed you feel today, however not ready you feel, you are adequately prepared, you are adequately connected, and it's going to be fine. I didn't coordinate with Victoria about speeches, but I also was thinking a lot about the impact of the fire and the pandemic on this class. I believe that your life is a curriculum that was created just for you. And this pandemic and this wildfire were a part of your curriculum. And there is something that they were supposed to teach you. And I've been reflecting, you know, what lessons might you get from these things that I want to pass on. I want to tell you how much I wish I could give each of you a fleece blanket right now. I'm so sorry. Instead, I'll try to be brief. When I thought about lessons you might get from this pandemic wildfire graduation class that you are having, one that I hope you take is that these things were systemic. They look like isolated events in some way, but they weren't. A pandemic that raged out of control far beyond what it needed to be was a result of a failed system. And wildfires that are happening in the context of global crisis is another example of a failed system. We didn't do what we needed to do to prevent climate crisis. We could have. We could live differently on this planet, and we chose not to. We could have had chosen a system of mutual care in the context of a pandemic, and we chose not to. And these things raged out of control beyond what any of us can actually do today. But they are systems that failed. We can design them differently, and you will need to, because we're exceeding the resources of this planet to hold the systems that we've created. So I also hope that you take from this curriculum radical imagination. I think it is very fair if in the context of this pandemic wildfire graduation, you feel anxious or just stressed about the world on top of all the other things you feel. Own that, feel that, that is really fair. But I hope that you also can channel into radical imagination about how might these things be different? How can they influence you so that you radically imagine a new future, new systems, and it's gonna be incumbent on all of you to do that, so I really encourage it. Every system is a choice. Every system of government, every system of economics, every system of mutual care. And you are in a place to redesign them together. I also hope, thank you. I also hope that you will feel the power of community. All change happens in community. I have never done anything alone. You know, I have a skill set I'm proud of, but there is always something else needed. And the community here has held you together in this crisis. That is a part of the curriculum. I hope you will keep it forever. The power of community is how social change happens. Relationships are the infrastructure of social change, so invest in those. Continue to invest in them, continue to hold them. I also hope that you will hold that the most impacted communities have the best answers. In the midst of the fire, no one knew what you needed better than you did. And that is true in any crisis. And I want to say that philanthropy, where I work, international aid, are basically centered around the idea that certain people, the folks with the resources, have the best answers. And that is one of the reasons we fail, because the answers are actually in the communities who just need to be resourced to find their own solutions. And so I hope one of the ways that you all will radically reimagine systems is to center the genius of the communities that are impacted by climate crisis, by authoritarianism, by human rights abuses, by women's rights abuses. Those people have the answers, and center that. There is no reason for top-down approaches anymore. They don't work. I want to give one example from my own work is that we ran a climate campaign at Donors of Color where I got to meet with 37 of the top 40 climate funders, mostly presidents, almost all white men, who are the folks who've been funding the solutions to climate change. And I took the opportunity to look right in their eyes and say, you have failed. And one of the ways you have failed is in not seeing the people who needed to be resourced to be a part of this challenge. You have not resourced the communities who have the most to lose and therefore have the best solutions, including the developing world, including communities of color, and that your commitment to racial justice or social justice needs to not be rhetoric and words. It needs to land in a budget. It needs to actually show up in numbers. It needs to show up in spreadsheets. And what I heard from all of the 37 of the 40 top climate funders we met with was, we believe in everything you're doing. We think that what you're doing is great. We love racial justice. And we just want you to understand that what we are doing is trying to reduce the amount of carbon in the atmosphere. And you know, this inclusion stuff is really wonderful, but like we have a focus that we are trying to like really reduce carbon. And for me, it's like, oh, you have a massive blind spot that is where you're failing because you don't have the right people in the decision-making positions to tell you that you cannot make the bold sweeping change you need to make that reduces carbon in the atmosphere if you do not have the political will, if you do not have a majority of people behind you, you won't do it. And so a technocratic approach is important. Like you need the technocratic solutions, but you need people to actually make sure those things happen. You need an effective government to make sure that happens. And if you fail to include those people, you get what we have right now. So again, I invite your radical imagination. I also want to tell you that social change is hard. I think I had this idea when I was sitting in your seat that you know I would always sort of be on the side of righteousness with other righteous people. And that then the people who were bad would be clearly delineated. And that has never been the case. And I just want you to be prepared for that. I'm at a stage in my career where I now get called visionary pretty often, and that's nice. But what being visionary means actually is that you're out of step most of the time because you're trying to be somewhere that most people aren't. And that is actually not popular. It's really not. Get used to friction, but also choose your validators. You are in some of the best company you will ever be in right this second. So think about the values that you're holding. Think about the people whose approval you want. Hold them really close, because when other people disapprove, you need to know like what your moral core is. And even when you feel out of step, even when you feel constant friction, remember that every system, including the ones that caused the pandemic, including the ones that caused wildfires, has people who are invested in it. And it wouldn't be this way if someone powerful was not profoundly invested in it being this way. So get comfortable being out of step. Get comfortable being uncomfortable. And then the last thing I want to really invite you all to do and to take, you know, as your pandemic curriculum, is the importance of your joy. Your joy, your love. We have a saying at Donors of Color that love is a competitive advantage, and I 1,000% believe that. We can't do the work well if we're unhappy. We can't do it well with sharp elbows. We don't do it well when we are fighting for our own money, power, you know, whatever. Like, that brought us the systems we have. But when you are working in loving community, in loving relationships, you are powerful beyond measure. So invest in what you love. I also suggest you invest in your skill sets, whatever they are, whatever brings you joy. You know, if it is music, then do the music. Music is a powerful form of social protest and social impact, whatever it is that you're good at, if you're a scientist, but get good at that skill set and you will have something to contribute. You'll also know when you don't know, which is something that is actually a bigger skill than you think, to understand what it is that you have expertise in and what it is that you don't have expertise in. I want to close with a quote from Yoda. Always in motion is the future. Always in motion is the future. And I am so proud to be here talking to all of you because I think you will be the architects of that motion. On behalf of your families, on behalf of your teachers, your administrators, the communities you will come into, I just want to say we love you, we support you, we have your backs, and we can't wait to see what you do next.
Thank you, Ashindi, for reminding us of radical imagination. Yes! Oh, these are Ashindi's fans from way back, I bet. That's very cool. Ashindi, thank you for reminding us of the power of turning words into actions, and thank you for your radical imagination and the ways that you're changing the world. And now we're going to go to the conferral of diplomas. It's time!
Class of 2022, this will be the last time I call your names. Miyu Arai, Japan. Juan Asensio, Chile. Bubakar Alkali Balo. Yabsira Gasha Biswalam, Ethiopia. Romina Bonomi, Uruguay. Jason Boramia, Lebanon. Sabine Violet Bruno, United States, Virginia. Ricardo Buondono, Italy. Tiana, Bushnak, United Arab Emirates, and Jordan. Sahara, Sky, Canem, Fishley, Dominica, and Canada. Hector Ceballos, United States, Oklahoma. Charlotte Chen, United States, Missouri. Henri, Shikada, Japan. Nicholas Kawamura de Souza, United States, New Jersey, and Brazil. Zed Davidson, Italy, United States, and Canada. Luandile Dlamini, South Africa. Ha Duan, Vietnam. Oliver Doak, United States, Kentucky. Alec Thomas Eckert, United Kingdom and France. Renata Espinosa Gonzalez, Mexico. Guadalupe Maria Savannah Shira Gallegos, United States, New Mexico, Mexico, and Genisaro Nation. Elias Gaudry, France. Lakshri Gautam, United States, Massachusetts, and Nepal. Alexandra Maria Gomberg Shkolnikova, Mexico. Silenis Hernandez, Panama. Daniel Guzman, United States, Maryland, and Ukraine. Kong Phuong, Vietnam. Jose Carlos Hernandez Perosina, Guatemala. Emma Irvonen, Finland. Corrine Eide, United States, Montana. Ahmed Jamaluddin, United States, Georgia, and South Africa. Leka Joy, United States, Washington. Gianna Cambo, India. Yeah.
Onguru, Hufsaya, Mongolia. Rigdon, Phuntsuk, Lama, United States, Nepal, and Tibet. Rachel, Leung, Hong Kong, and Taiwan. Kingston, Liu, Yen, Wei, Hong Kong, and Malaysia. Or Malaysia, Malaysia.
I feel that. I know, I got it.
Angel Lee, now Hong Kong and Malaysia. Nina Vered Lidar, United States, California. Trygve Lillehammer, Norway. Amory Ling, United States, Massachusetts. Raymond Liu Ao, United States, California, and Peru. Christopher Bastian Lundgren, United States, Oregon, and Netherlands. Mohamedou Mujahid Mohamedou Noradini Moussa, Niger. Kyle John Owen Malis, United States, Wisconsin. Evie Manton, Great Britain and Ireland. Natasha Leia Maringa Marangu, United States, California. Seneme Simfiwe Mashaba, the Kingdom of Eswatini. Dayanara Bravo de Laguna Mallorquin, Nicaragua. Rita Menja, United States, Oklahoma, and Kenya. Gustavo Merino, Mexico. Jessica Miller, Great Britain. Nora June Most, United States, New Mexico. Lena Molnar, Hungary. Mihiro Moroi, Japan. Cleanwell Trevor Mwaluanda, Malawi. Namso Ki Norbu, United States, New York, and Tibet. Maria Stanislavivna Novakova, Ukraine. Carla Olivo, Dominican Republic and United States, Illinois. Melvin Ose Opoku, Ghana. But then we got that. Do Uzurhan, Turkey. Gizem Elida Özturk, the Netherlands and Turkey. Ian Palanga, Togo and Ukraine. Sofia Pavlenko, United States, New Mexico, Ukraine, and Russia. Florencia Perez, Uruguay. Adele Plard, United States and France. Tashi Rai, United States, Massachusetts and India. Halel Ref Tagari, Israel. Alicia Rodrigo, Ireland and Spain. Joaquin, Santiago, Isidro, Paul, Romero, United States, New Mexico. Sophia Lee Yin Root, United States, Massachusetts, and Singapore. Ruta Rupekite, Lithuania. Malena Samson, Germany. Leo Damian Sanchez, United States, Washington. Mario Sanz Majuelo, Spain. Verona Miel Scarpula, United States, Louisiana. Helen Anna Scher, Switzerland. Eleonora Scognamiglio, Italian. Shubhangini Shah, Nepal. Crystal Shang, Canada and China. Anson Seidel, United States. Vidushi Singh, Tanzania. Mario Sitoi, Mozambique. Jonah Lorraine Sommer, Germany. Yeah. Nicole Sosa Diquez, Trinidad and Tobago. Andrew Hao Su, Hong Kong. Juno Shozda, Great Britain and Poland. Idil Tok, Turkey. Musa Tora, Afghanistan. Ankush Trivedi, United States, New Jersey. Perseverance Unger, United States, California. Camila Coromoto Vargas Calatayud, Venezuela. Mihailo Vidaković, Bosnia and Herzegovina and Serbia. Cindy Stephen Wani, United States, North Carolina, and South Sudan. Mark Mulai Stephen Wani. Aisha Wanjiku, Kenya. Yes! Eleanor Leffler Wilson, United States, North Carolina. Johnny Wodi, Nigeria. Grace Shia, United States, New Mexico, and Taiwan. Riku Yamada, Japan. Gurong Zhang, China. Lucia Suvela, Argentina. Temple Shema, Rwanda.
Spoken like a true mama. That is exactly right. Class of 2022, will you please stand up and join us facing the community? Follow my gesture. Families, guests, friends, getaway families, faculty, staff, first years, evacuees, mariachis, I present to you Tomas, my husband, who hadn't seen me in weeks. May I present to you the class of 2022. And now, if you will all be seated, we have just a couple of more things to do, a little housekeeping, and then there will be plenty of time for photos. Thank you. First years, please stand up. You now see the chairs at the front that have been vacated by our class of 2022. Please come take those chairs as you will be leading your firsties next year. Now, as our first years take their places, all right, everybody, if I can have your attention for just a moment, we will be serving lunch. There are box lunches in the New Mexico room building. If you go in and go to your right, you'll be able to get a box lunch. I know with the cold, we're gonna be tempted to stay in the building, but there is another event happening after us, and that's what the inside tables are set up for. So all of us will be eating outside on picnic tables, as well as on the other side of the building. Is that clear to everybody? We're not eating inside the building. So huddle up to keep warm. And if we could just have a moment. We've lost them, haven't we? Waterfall. It's like magic. Okay. One last thing before the mariachi send us off with some music. Okay? Let's take a moment to feel the joy that the class of 2022 is feeling. But let's also take a moment to remember everyone who is staying here in New Mexico and will continue to fight this fire. And will continue to figure out how to deal with the displacement that has taken place as a function of the fire. And let's just remember that all of us, by what we do, can make a difference for everyone who is experiencing difficulty. And let's hold both of those things, joy and concern for our fellow human beings, at the same time. Congratulations, class of 2022. We are so proud of you. Join us for lunch, please.
favorite.